It's a kind of magic. It's a kind of magic. A kind of magic. One dream, one soul, one prize, one gold, one golden glance of what should be.
Hello and welcome to the Gallant Fuse History Show, our periodic look back at events, games, players, anything in general that's happened over the history of our magnificent club. My name's Colin McDuff, and joining me today is Graeme Curry. Graeme, how are you?
Very well, Colin. Yeah, looking forward to this one. I do like a bit of history myself, especially the history of Rangers. My favourite topic to talk about, so glad to be here.
Glad to have you on. So kick us off then. I'll let you introduce today's topic and why.
Sure. So today's topic is the Drybrough Cup Final of 1979. And I've chose it because the goal by Davie Cooper is something that I watched on repeat many, many a time. I first seen it watching the Rangers Gold video. Now, I can't remember if it was Rangers Gold or Rangers Gold 2, but it was on one of those VHS tapes, and I must have got it for my Christmas, and it's one of the VHS tapes that I have played and played and played, and I just loved that goal. I loved watching Davie Cooper doing it. Davie Cooper was a hero of mine. He was one of my favourite Rangers players when I was young. So I wanted to look back at that goal, because that's all I ever seen of it, was just that goal. And then when Sandy Jardine passed away a few years ago, his goal in the same game was brought to prominence, and I hadn't realised it wasn't the same game. So it was just a game that I wanted to look back on and delve a little bit deeper into. And it was quite interesting to look back. It wasn't just those two goals. There was actually three goals in the game, which we're going to talk about. And actually, all three goals were cracking goals.
Yeah, they really were. Really were cracking goals. We'll come on to the three goals, but I just want to echo that. I didn't know anything about the Sandy Jardine goal until this video came out about maybe 4 or 5 years ago. I don't know if it was actually after he passed away, actually. The video started circulating. I'd never seen it before. And I, as you say, three very well taken goals. Just on Davie Cooper, is the reason you loved him so much is because he's a fellow left pegger, is that it?
Yeah, that was it. I was always wanted to be a left winger. I always tried to play like him, dribble, go fast and dribble and beat players and cross the ball and set goals up. That was kind of what I liked to do, and that's what I liked to watch. Even after Davie Cooper left Rangers, it was always the wingers that excited me, left or right, obviously mainly left, because that's the position I played as a youngster. But Davie Cooper for me was just outstanding, and a real hero of mine.
So the tournament itself, Graeme, then, the Drybrough Cup, so this was a friendly tournament that was held in the 70s, and it was always held 2 weeks before the season kicked off. I think it initially ran between 71 and 75, had a break for a couple of years, and then came back for the 79-80 season, the one we're going to talk about, and its last ever outing was in the 80-81 season, or before the 80-81 season, I should say. So it always consisted of 8 teams. I find this is quite an interesting concept. The 4 highest scoring teams for the previous season's Premier League and the 4 highest scoring teams from the previous season's First Division. So I think this was an attempt for the SFA at the time to try and promote a bit of attacking football.
Yeah, that was the reason for the invites. But the SFA didn't initially sanction the tournament. It was actually a tournament because they didn't agree with sponsorship at the time. So none of their tournaments had sponsorship. And the Drybrough Cup, the Drybrough Brewery, they created this tournament for that benefit so that they could actually sponsor it. So they created this tournament on the back of that. But yeah, it was that exactly that idea. It was to create lots of goals. That was the expectation. 8 attacking teams in Scotland, and it was seeded as well. So the first round, it was only ever a quarter, a semi, and a final. And in the quarters, a Premier team would always play a first division team. So it was kind of seeded that way. But yeah, it was also a tournament that was used for experimental reasons. So I don't know if you noticed that in any of your research, but they trialled sort of things like offside rules, and the offside rule was changed so that you could only be offside if you were over the 18 or within 18 yards of goal. So you couldn't be offside basically in the opposition half unless you were in their box or wide. So it was used as well as a trial for a few different rules. I don't think any of them stuck. I think it became confusing.
Just as well, man. That sounds terrible.
Well, is it any different to the offside rule the last few years? Because I'm baffled watching football nowadays, trying to work out when an offside and when it's no, and first rule, first phase of play and second phase of play. So I guess we've always tried to tinker with the offside rule to make it work and make it more exciting. And this cup was one of the vehicles for that.
Looking back in, I'll be honest, I took a lot for follow and reading a lot of the members' memories of stuff like the Drybrough Cup, or even going back to like the Glasgow Cup and speaking to like my dad and my uncles and stuff. Even though this is a friendly tournament, it seems that there was a bigger focus on like kind of summer tournaments and friendly tournaments that you probably don't get anymore, do you?
No, I mean, I think back to the Tennent Sixes as well. I used to love watching the Tennent Sixes. I think I went to a couple of them as well. And that was kind of like a warm-up, but it was just an exhibition. You know, it was an exhibition of football. But no, we don't seem to have that sort of thing. It's obviously more geared towards a training programme and as well probably money. You know, you're trying to get big glamour friendly so you can get gate money. And if we go to play another team abroad, I guess we get money. We get paid a fee, a match fee. So there's a money element of it as well, which I guess is just, well, it's part and parcel of the game now. But it is a bit sad you don't get these sort of exhibition things that I remember.
So Rangers were one of the top four highest scoring teams in the Premier Division in the 78-79 season. So that season they came second in the league. They actually won the domestic cup double, Scottish Cup and League Cup, got to the quarter final of the European Cup. So that was all in John Gregg's first season in charge, and he's grown into his second. Obviously this is that, like, in hindsight, this is probably one of the kind of highlights of John Gregg's spell overall. He obviously never won the league. I don't know if you know too much about that. And that time when John Gregg was in charge, obviously took over for Jock Wallace winning the treble. That must have been a hard gig to follow for anybody, to be fair.
Aye, absolutely. I mean, it's a tough, he's obviously in that position because he was a fantastic captain and he led the team, but it just didn't work out for him as a manager. It just didn't work out for him at Rangers. I don't think he got and I don't think he had the team as well. I mean, I don't know. I wasn't born at this point, I should say. You know, so I wasn't born when we're talking about this period. So I'm looking back and I'm just going by other people's accounts of it and reading books about Rangers as I like to do. But by all accounts, he didn't quite have the team in order to challenge. A lot of the players were coming to the end of their careers. So I think he had a bit of a rebuilding. When we talk about the 79 Cup, I think there's three starters from the 1972 Cup Winners' Cup final. So these guys are coming to the end of their career, and he did have a bit of a rebuild job on his hand. One thing we can say about John Greig is he brought a Super Alley, so not all bad.
No, not all bad. And, you know, this day we're going to talk about is certainly not all bad at all. So just in a bit of context, I found this really, like this was mind-blowing. You would never get this. You would never get this nowadays. So going back to, there was very few sponsored tournaments in Britain, I'd say, never mind Scotland. But Rangers actually held a friendly tournament between 76 and 79. It was the Tennis Caledonian Cup. And this happened to coincide with the same weekend of the Drybrough Cup Final. So Rangers obviously getting through to the Drybrough Cup Final. They beat Kilmarnock 2-0 on Wednesday, the 1st of August. Which would have been the quarterfinal, sorry. 2 days later, they beat West Ham in the semi-final of the Tennis Caledonian Cup. That was Friday, the 3rd of August. The day we're talking about comes the day after, where they're playing Celtic, and then the day after that, they're playing Kilmarnock in the Tennis Caledonian Cup. So that's 4 games in 5 days. All very much, they would have been the same players, pretty much featuring. You would never get that at all anymore.
No, that's incredible, isn't it? And we just, you hear about managers like Guardiola and Klopp moaning about the fixture pile-up and the schedule pile-up. These guys are football players, man. They should just be able to go and play football. Doesn't matter. Well, albeit, I get that is very tight, though. Four games in 5 days is very tight. But it just shows you the players just get on with it. They just carried on and continued to be successful as well during that period, winning games.
Absolutely different breed of, to say different breed of player, but different breed of society back then. It was very much a get up and go on with it, dust yourself down, kind of thing. Wee bit of sawdust, you'll be fine.
You wonder as well, I don't know about the pace of the game, if the Caledonian Cup games, if they were maybe a little bit slower, because it's pre-season, so maybe that's just the pre-season routine for these teams. So, you know, maybe there was a little bit of slower pace or a pre-season friendly feel to these games, and it wasn't quite at the total match pace, although I don't think the Drybrough Cup final would have been played at a reduced pace. I think that would have been full pelt, being an Old Firm derby.
No, absolutely not. So before we go to the final, Rangers beat Berwick Rangers 1-0 in the first game. That was the Saturday before in the Drybrough Cup. Then on the Wednesday, beat Kilmarnock 2-0, as I mentioned, and meeting Celtic in the final. Obviously, the games either side of the final were for the Tennis Caledonian Cup. Rangers ended up losing on the final day to Kilmarnock on penalties. It was 2-2 full time. Kilmarnock won 5-4. But on the build up to this game, on the Saturday morning papers, there was quite a few papers writing Rangers off, and very much, obviously Celtic won the league the season before. Oh, sorry, was it Aberdeen? I better double check that. No, I'm sure it was Celtic. Won the league the season before. A wee bit fresher than Rangers, it'd be fair to say. So very much had this as a bit of a foregone conclusion, or at the very least an uphill battle for Rangers. So Rangers lined up Peter McCloy in goals, back four of Alec Miller, Ali Dawson, Sandy Jardine playing sweeper, and Colin Jackson. Then I think it's a midfield four: Kenny Watson, Davie Cooper, Bobby Russell, Derek Parlane, and then Ali McDonald and John McDonald complete the 11. About a few famous names in there, Graham, as you mentioned, a couple remaining for the 72 Cup Winners' Cup team.
Yeah, so you've got McCloy in goals there, you've got Sandy Jardine and Derek Johnston, I think, came on in the game. So yeah, there's a definite bit of experience in there. I don't know if it's experience or old age, but yeah, the guys were maybe certainly coming to the end of their career, but definite legends in there. And a guy that I'd Never heard he was Kenny Watson until I started reading up on this. I had never known him as a Rangers player, to be honest. He's never came across my radar and anything I've read up him before. But yeah, he'd been with his 5 years, left at the end of 1980. So yeah, it's always nice to come across these guys that you'd never heard of before.
No, absolutely. Definitely been there for 5 years, so he's obviously played his part. He would have been there for the George Wallace's last Treble team. So I think, yeah, and again, disclaimer, listeners, many of you would know that there's a cracking theme in the video of the highlights. And when I say the highlights, the four goals in the game. But there wasn't any television footage because it was a pre-season tournament. It wasn't televised. The highlights actually came from the Drybrough Brewery. They brought in their own cameraman, and this was these were the only remaining videos were for the goals. So we're very much going on newspaper reports and, you know, recollections for fans and journalists going back and looking back. But I think it was a fairly tight affair the first 10 minutes or so, but the Rangers actually go and get the first goal 13 minutes in through John McDonald. So a guy I didn't know too much about, Graeme, John McDonald actually went on to win the Young Player of the Year that season. I think he must have been about 20. I think he was at Rangers for a couple of years. Did you know much about him?
I'd known John McDonald. I had came across him in my prior reading of Rangers and understanding, and yeah, he seemed to be a good player. Never seen him play myself, but yeah, must have been a player if he's managed to get Young Player of the Year. But this was a good goal that he scored. But just to go back just briefly, I think you said that there's no cameras there. I've not great research that I've done for this, but there's two reasons that I think that there wasn't any filming. It was because either there was a strike on at the time, so there was one of the engineers who worked the cameras, or you know, the infrastructure, the staff behind the video production, they were on strike at the time, is my understanding. That might be one of the reasons. And then also the BBC weren't there because it was just a Drybrough Cup, because it wasn't an SFA sanctioned tournament. But I think from my reading that it's probably due to the strike that there wasn't any, any cameras there, and we're left with just a single guy in the crowd with a camcorder, basically trying to film it. It's kind of like a TikTok that was getting made on the day or something.
What are you doing with the kids? Citing TikTok. I was thinking that when I read the BBC didn't they film it, but I was thinking surely you'd get somebody else. It would have been a freelance cameraman or a camera technician or whatever, but it's just an MD who's watched the goals back. You can see it's very, very shaky hands, man. So it's just some guy with a camcorder. But the first goal, this is a cracking goal, isn't it, Graham?
Yeah, fantastic. He's done well to put it away. Took it well. He's skinned somebody, came in for the left-hand side, and he skinned the boy, and then he's just put it in the back of the net. But just well-controlled, you know, he could... reminiscent of Durant for me, the way he's got a low centre of gravity, but still able to turn. That was the kind of images it was conjuring up as I watched this goal back. Was a wee bit of Durant about him. So, but no, fantastic and a great start. You know, kind of beat an early goal like that in an Old Firm game.
Yeah, actually, when he comes in, when he skins the boy, he actually comes in, plays the 1-2 with Cooper. But Cooper just takes a one touch and they kind of reverse pass. But John McDonald, as soon as he plays the ball into Cooper, he's running exactly where Cooper plays the ball. It's just, you love seeing that. You know, you and I talk about it all the time, the intelligent football and off the ball movement. He knows exactly what he's doing, gets himself in a great position, and a lovely finish. Left-footed finish as well, you would have been chuffed with that. That's...
Yeah, got to be. Best players in the world are left-footed.
You put yourself in that bracket, aye. So, But again, going with the reports at this point, the Celtic start to try and open up, but Rangers really start to dominate. The pressure's off Rangers, and I think Celtic have maybe gone for a bit too much, and they are really, Rangers getting forward, being able to try and pick them off. Second goal comes in the 28th minute by Sandy Jardine. So I want to read out a headline for the Mail Sport the next day. This really, really surprised me about how fine a goal this was, because as you and I were saying, everybody remembers this game for Davie Cooper's first goal, but I'll read the quote. So the headline is Sparkling Jardine, and the first few sentences of the column open with, the toast is Sandy Jardine. He can stash away the beer mugs, for it was a champagne goal by the Rangers skipper that paralysed Celtic. When he whipped the ball away from Roy Aitken at the edge of the box in the 28th minute, there was a murmur of approval from one end of the ground. Several seconds later, the referee could have shouted, "Last orders, please," because no one was going to see anything better than that goal. One of the most spectacular ever at Hampden in this hectic Drybrough Cup final. The season hasn't started yet, and already 40,609 have seen the goal of the season. They could have served the champers there and then. So that's not the only report to say that the finest goal to be scored at Hampden, or one of the finest to be scored at Hampden. And that really surprised me, because before a couple of years ago, I never knew anything about this goal.
Yeah, and it's just went right under the radar for guys our age, or, you know, round about our age, people that weren't there at the time, younger fans won't even know about it really. But it is just one of the best goals ever at Hampden, but one of the best goals in an Old Firm final, the best Old Firm game even. To win it in your own box, you know, he's left Aitken for dead. Aitken was a decent player as well. He was okay, I thought, as a player. I remember him. He must have been young at the time if he was playing in that game, because I remember Aitken playing. But to have left him for dead on the 18-yard line, and then to just charge up the right wing, we don't know exactly what's happened. I don't know if we beat any players or if it was just a lung-busting sprint, because the footage doesn't show us that. But what it does show us is the cut inside for the right on his left foot, and he just thunders it past the keeper. But yeah, to have that much energy, to have that much drive to get forward as a centre-half he was playing, you know, what's Big Boogie must have been watching him when he was playing football.
I think, yeah, when he gets the ball and he reaches it, I think he beats Aitken, leaves him for dead, as you say. He beats another player when he gets to the halfway line, and then also going into the box, the feigned right-footed shot, and the left peg, brilliant finish, and playing it sweeper as well. I don't think very many people would think about Sandy Jardine playing sweeper, never mind a lung-busting run for sweeper. I think it just really shows you that how fine a player he was.
Yeah, and he continued it, you know, so he then went on to be, years and years later, I think it was probably 85 or 86, Jardine went to Hearts and was player of the year there. He played centre-half, and he just conducted their defence. He was the main man for Hearts and became player of the year there. So although he was probably best known as a right-back for Rangers, or that's how I know him certainly, he did his job at centre-half or sweeper anyway. Because he was such a good football player, and he could start attacks and he could run like that. So, yeah, fantastic goal.
Sandy Jardine, what he had to say about that goal, and being asked about it years later, "I scored one of my best goals that day, and it hardly got a mention." And we're going to talk about why. So Rangers going to half-time, 2-0 up. Very much for the majority of the second half, it's very Rangers dominated. And the third goal, and the reason why you've picked this, comes in the 78th minute, Graeme. So talk us through this goal by Davie Cooper.
Yeah, so it's all done in the Celtic box, the Celtic penalty box. And I don't think there'll be many Rangers fans who haven't seen this goal. So you'll probably know it yourselves, but it's really just unbelievable skill, close control. People talk about having a ball on a bit of string, and that's the way he seemed to have it. He was just in total control of this ball, and the defence were going left, right, ducking underneath balls. He just couldn't get near him. He just could not get near Cooper. He lifted it air the guy's head. He lifted it air another guy's head. There's chest controlling amongst that, and then he just slots it past the keeper. I feel like if we had the production skills at the Gallant Few, Queen's It's a Kind of Magic should be playing in the background, because that's the song that's in my head whenever I see that goal. And it goes back to that Rangers Gold video, because that was playing in the background, and it's in my head every time I watch that goal. So we probably don't have the skills to dump that over, but yeah, what a fantastic goal. And just one of these things that made me fall in love with Cooper was because that was not out of character for him. He had the ability to do that any game. You know, he just, the close control, the skill, he's just fantastic.
Aye, and I don't really know what else to say. When you mentioned that it's, everybody will know this goal, it doesn't matter if you were born in 72 or 92 or 2002, you would have seen this goal, and you will have you will have Queen playing in your head as well. And this may be a bit controversial, but I actually think, see the ball in for Alex McDonald, I think that's quite a poor ball. The camera might be doing it injustice, but I don't know why he's not played it in his feet and he's lobbed it in his chest.
Yeah, doesn't matter. You get to Cooper and he'll do whatever you want with it. Touch of magic. But he's throwing it down his chest and then keep you up. So keep you up goal, as it's sometimes called. But just words can't describe just how clever it was, how self-aware and aware of his surroundings that he was to be able to do that. It was fabulous. Loved it, loved it, loved it. Could watch it a million times.
Cooper had what he had to say after the game that day. We were so much on top that we could have netted six and that score will still have flattered Celtic. Obviously, I was pleased with the goal. I scored two, because you don't score like that very often. More's the pity. And no, you're right, you really don't. That kind of post-match reaction for him, that kind of ties into what a lot of the Celtic players and the journals were saying at that point after as well. Danny McGrain even described it as a goal born of utter self-belief and complete cheek. And that's probably what, going by what I've heard about Cooper, you would have watched him a lot more closely, but it's that fine line, but it's not quite arrogance, but just complete self-belief and the kind of the cheeky cockiness that you love in winners, isn't it?
Aye, he just had that confidence. Cooper was just so confident on the ball. The drop of a shoulder, he could just beat a man, just be shrugging his shoulder to the right-hand side, and the defender would run the other way. Cooper didn't need to touch a ball to beat a man. He was just incredible. And then it wasn't just that, but the way he could cross a ball, the amount of times that the ball would come in for a left, it was lovely football that he used to be able to do. Just a joy to watch with Cooper. Made me fall in love with football. My hero.
And it's probably right that this game is remembered very much for David Cooper, but you don't want him to. I think the big reason why I wanted to do this as well, when you mentioned it, is to kind of call out these other two goals as well. What's that? 42 years on, and what everybody knows roughly something about the Drybrough Cup. They know the Drybrough Cup in 79 was a thing, even though if you don't know the ins and outs of it. So it is still such an iconic game looking back into it.
And as you say, that we said it earlier at the beginning, is everybody probably does know the Cooper goal, but maybe not everybody knows the Sandy Jardine goal and the McDonald goal, because they probably weren't on the videos, they weren't showing as much, or they haven't been shown anyway. So, yeah, to look back and actually see that, it's probably a bit of a shame that Sandy Jardine's hasn't been credited as much. I know that it has been the newspaper reports that you've read out, but they don't seem to have. It's not had the longevity the way Cooper's goal did.
No, but if there's any consolation, in the player ratings, in the Mail Sport the next day, Sandy Jardine was the only player on the pitch to get a 5 out of 5 rating. So at least I'm guessing he got man of the match, and so at least he got that recognition there and then, I suppose.
How weird was that when you started looking at the match ratings and they were only up to 5 and you seen some players getting a 2 out of 5? How can that be?
Well, at first it took me a couple of seconds to realise that this wasn't out of 10. I thought that must have been a shite game.
2 out of 10. Yeah, very odd. You only get 5. I've never seen that before.
So that's kind of all we know about this iconic game, because of the cameraman strike, and we can all really go on recollection. But Graham, it's, you know, I know I watched the 3 goals time. And, oh, sorry, I should mention Celtic got a late consolation late on, but that doesn't fucking matter. As David Cooper said, by all accounts, Rangers should have took 6 after them and it would have flattered Celtic. But just looking back at these goals and looking back at what it was like at the time, I think this should always go down as an iconic game. In 2001, there was a supporters poll on the greatest ever Rangers goal, and the 3rd goal was voted as the greatest ever Rangers goal. So I think it's only right that we do remember this.
It gets my vote, certainly gets my vote. And it would have been worth the £2 ticket price to get in. £2 to get in 1979. And the programme was 10 pence. No bad, eh? £2 for a programme.
£2, 10 pence, and you can get a... You could probably get a pie at Ibrox where it's roasting hot and fucking inside a pure crusty, and it sticks to the wee... sticks to the wee time foil tray on the outside.
Aye, I know where my value would be.
Anything else you want to cover off in this before we wrap up?
Did you want to say what happened the season after? Were you going to say, did you want to go into what happened the season finish? I don't have anything, but just in case. I know you had it in your notes.
Angry Rangers came 5th that year.
Ah, no, worth mentioning. Nah, then. I don't think I've got anything else to add. Don't think so. No, I don't have anything.
No.
No, not for me.
Well, oh fuck. Well, reminiscing about ticket prices probably seems a nice way to finish off before we start before I start bawling my eyes out how much I spent in Rangers over the years. But listeners, if you've got any memories of this game or any other research, if you were too young to be there, or if you were at the game, we'd love if you go in touch in the comments, let us know your thoughts on this game, the goals itself, and what it was like if you were there. Also left to do is thank you to Graeme Curry for coming on.
Thanks, Colin. Good to look back.
Yeah, always is. And thanks for listening. Take care.